Hello everyone, and welcome back to my colonization series in Kerbal Space Program 0.25. In this episode, I hope to rectify some of the problems we had in previous episodes. And the first thing is to solve the problem that caused the incredible lag when we were trying to land the Colony Control Center on the Moon. And so, whoever said in the comments that it was Rover Delivery A debris, congratulations, you won the sweepstakes. That is, in fact, what caused the problem. I don't know why, but extensive testing shows that this piece of debris is what was causing all the lag. So we are going to terminate it. Bye-bye to that debris. So unfortunately, we did lose a carbonite miner that was dropped on the surface, but at least we can, let's go to the emergency habitat launch to verify that the lag is no longer there. Okay, and here we are, and frame rates are good. I'm getting 20. Okay, and at this point I should mention a few things. I have made a few changes. First of all, I've updated all the USI mods, especially since they apparently changed from TGA to PNG files for the textures, which helps with the RAM. It didn't help enough with the RAM though, and so I have had to install Active Texture Management Aggressive, which saved me about 300 megabytes of RAM. Not as much as you'd expect normally from the aggressive version of Active Texture Management, but such is the situation I have. But yep, now there was another suggestion that somebody had for solving our little emergency hab problem, and I'm going to try it out, though this could end in disaster, so I'm going to have the Kerbals step aside safely. Well, one of them is going to have to do part of the work, but first of all, I'm going to get Jorvi Kerman safely face planting off to the side. Come on, Jorvi. Standard protocol, meet by the flag. Okay, and now back. MechJeb seems to have an instance for every single, not every single craft I have, every single command module, I guess. Though that doesn't seem right. I think I have got more than, I've got four at least. I've got four. But it's only got three instances. I have no idea what causes MechJeb to multiply like this. We have more than that in terms of command modules. Okay, anyway, so Desrick is going to grab the inflatable habitation module. And actually, let me have you come over this way, Desrick. Ah, he looks so funny with that thing on top of him. Okay, don't glitch into anything. All right. So now the suggestion was to use one of these, or something like it, any sort of inflatable thing. USI comes with quite a lot of them. But to attach it and see if it can prop the whole thing up. This could be pretty bad. Let's see. Looks a bit off-center, doesn't it? Oh, how many of these do we get? Oh no, I think it's just the same one. Okay, so let's say, I'll just grab that thing. Okay, right, now attach. Let's try and get a little bit more on center here. And you can see why I had the Kerbals clear away. That's pretty close. Okay, Desiree, could you step aside? We could probably lose some solar panels at least from this. That's my expectation, but okay. Now, gonna get ready to engage the landing gear after this deploys. Okay, and landing gear. Come on. Okay. That didn't do well enough. I wish I had put some sort of reaction wheel on here. Might have helped. Okay. Alright, well, not too bad. Didn't lose anything. Yet. Sort of on its side, that's part of the problem. If I could turn it somehow, one way or another. Could use this one, but that would probably do too much. Let me try one more time. It's probably inadvisable, but... Ooh, come on. You can do it. Let's retract this. I don't know if it changes the center of mass. Okay, sort of, kind of. Huh, okay, it's a problem, we were on this slope, you see. But okay, who do we have now? No, that's the flag. I'm gonna have, who is this anyway? A Jorvi. I'm gonna have Jorvi pick up the inflatable habitation module. Okay, jetpack, face the target. Up you go. Oh wow, why are you going sideways? This way, please. Can you get to that? Maybe you have to be standing still to... Oh, no, you can grab it. Okay, off to the side, please. We don't want you knocking the hab too much. Okay, up. Don't knock the hab, come on. It's barely stable. Okay. Let's position you properly. We don't have symmetry anymore. Let me just... Maybe we should mount them lower. Here, let's see. Attach. Oh, that's too far away. Get closer. Okay. I might want to move the other one lower. Maybe this is a little bit too low. Well, that seems like an improvement. Okay, let's try and get the other one about the same. Handy stuff, this Kerbal attachment system. Could just be the slope. If you take a look at how far it is away from the top, could just be the angle I'm looking at it. Okay, I'm gonna go with that theory. Seems close enough to me. Okay, step aside, Jorvi. And then we gotta inflate these and see what happens. Remember, we do have a rescue pod if necessary. If these guys lose this emergency thing in any sort of eventuality, we can bring the rescue pod down. Okay, so that was part of the plan here. Okay, it doesn't quite touch the ground, but let's retract the landing gear now. Pretty good. Pretty good. I think it looks a little bit more stable now. Let's extend the remaining... Oh, did we lose a... I think we lost a solar panel here. this one. Okay, emergency hab seems to be finally fully functional here. And so let's get our Kerbals back in. So thank you in the comments for that that note. I didn't note the names before. Oh, now we've got four MechJebs. Anyway, I didn't note the names of the people who contributed before starting recording, so sorry about that. But, yeah, very helpful. Of course, if it had turned out badly, it would probably be a bad idea to mention who it was. Oh, dear. CLS, confusing me once again. This always worries me, because this means something went wrong, actually. Now, we've got a little bit of a problem in that I no longer have the fuel in the Super Orange to get the Colony Control Center down. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to try and hand it off to the Pumpkin instead. So that's the plan. And we'll once again try and get it to where... not that Super Orange is... actually, that's a good point. I should switch over to that and rename it the Tug, because that's what it is. Let me do that quickly. So here's our little Tug, and I'm going to rename it Module Tug, which is what it's supposed to do. And let's test drive it a little bit. Since I'm following the suggestions of comments, I'm going to switch to docking mode, because somebody recommended that. And indeed, it doesn't move very fast. Somewhat skiddy, but not too much. We'll need a version with RTGs. It's got solar panels right now, but that's not the best way of going about it. Okay, stop. It doesn't really need to move very fast, since it's just hauling modules around, preferably very slowly. Hopefully it'll work out. All right. So now, trying to bring the Colony Control Center down to this is basically the goal. And let me take a look at how much fuel we actually have in the Super Orange, which is carrying the Colony Control Center. Okay, so here it is. And yeah, there's no way we can do anything like this with only 659 meters per second of delta V left. So I'm going to have the Pumpkin rendezvous with this and take the Super Orange off and try and get the Pumpkin on. The problem is there's no real way of controlling the Colony Control Center once I've taken the Super Orange off. It's going to be a tricky docking. Not horrible, but just a little bit tricky. Let's get SAS on and turn Smart ASS off. Okay, so let me rendezvous the Pumpkin with it. So here we go with the Pumpkin. Pumpkin has plenty of delta V left over, plus plenty of charm. Okay, and we want to rendezvous with not the emergency hab launch, that one. I think I'm going to do a more complicated than usual maneuver to rendezvous, because I want to do it quickly. You can see our landing site is going to be moving into the dark pretty soon, so I'd rather not take more than one or two orbits to make the rendezvous. So I'm going to use a little bit more fuel in order to rendezvous quickly. And that's basically a little bit more than one orbit. Okay, 0.5 kilometers. Pretty good for a quick rendezvous like this. So there's no appreciable spin on the Pumpkin, by the way, as you can see. It's very controlled. Even at this thrust level, there was spin on the Super Orange. Just checking to see if any direction is going to give me any benefit for a quick burst. It's about 500 meters either way. Okay, so we are approaching. Okay, I'm now 100 meters away and I'm going to zero out my velocity here so that we can detach to super orange. Okay, that's better. Nope. 50 millimeters per second is as good as I can get it. Alright. Now, this needs to point in the right direction. Control from here. And I'm going to undock. Ooh, there was a spike in G-forces for some reason. No. There we go. And I'm going to want to offset this so it doesn't crash into the pumpkin. Ah, SAS would be helpful. Seriously, are we... I don't know. It's one of those times where I'm not sure it's really telling me where the docking port is properly here. But we've got magnetism. Now to take off SAS. And we're docked. Okay. Sort of a weird docking, but got it done. Now, our target is the base, and this time we hope not to have any frame rate issues. I'm sort of stress testing this whole thing. And just to note, we are on FAR 14.2 here. And so far, FAR has not randomly popped up. It has not caused any problems with switching vessels or anything like that. So far has behaved itself so far, and that's a positive. We do get occasional drops in frame rate, periodic, which means that it's something calculating stuff. Maybe we should use the landing, let's see what the landing prediction is. Landing guidance. Well, I mean, of course the landing prediction will be over here, but let's just see. Compared to what our target coordinates are. It's always good to have a little bit more. Well, maybe it's not. There's too many numbers here. Okay. Yeah. Well, it's still showing us that marker. That'll be fine. Okay, targets in sight. We seem to be approaching a little bit north. Not too much, actually. It might not even need to be. Why does this seem much more wiggly than with the Super Pumpkin? Maybe it's because I always landed... Not the Super Pumpkin, Super Orange. Oh boy, Super Pumpkin, that'd be something, huh? I think maybe... I don't know. I don't know why it's... Maybe it's because the Super Orange was launched in the dark. And it's just sort of an illusion that it was stable. Oh, I should check the moon scanner to see whether there's any carbonite in this location. I'm a little bit late for that, though. After all, I've updated all the USI mods, so maybe they've changed the carbonite locations a bit. They changed a lot of other stuff, after all. Including the folder structure, which was interesting. I am always distressed when mods change folder structure. Makes it a lot harder to tell whether I've really got equivalent installations. Not that much harder, but still. Up at that acceleration we seem to have some spin. That's not a problem. That's way above what we're supposed to be doing for lunar operations anyway. Okay, we appear to be reasonably lined up on approach here. Gonna make sure I'm controlling from the probe core up here. Hopefully that'll make everything so much better. Okay, here we go. 100 meters from the surface. Smart ASS is keeping us straight up. Horizontal speed is 33 millimeters per second. Fifty meters from the surface, we are at 2 meters per second. Ten meters within prescribed touchdown speeds. Okay, please, when I undock, let it be. Okay, undock and fly off. Very nice. Okay. Looks good to me. Gonna take Smart ASS off, turn SAS on. Don't need to overdo things here. Let's get back to orbit. No crazy spinning with the pumpkin. Plenty of delta V left to get to orbit. Okay, so pumpkin deployment of the Colony Control Center seems to be successful. Next thing we need to see if the tug can actually pull the Colony Control Center around. First of all, docking with it, which is sort of a trick, right? We could use the winch if docking does not work, but the primary goal is to actually use the docking ports to connect the tug to the modules. Okay, that is a sufficient orbit. Now, well, quickly I want to turn to our scanner to make sure that the site actually has carbonite at it. So let me go there. Okay, here is our scanner. And display carbonite hotspots, yes. I think it's highlighting that. Let's see, on the map. No. Focus on the moon. Yeah, I think we're still very well covered as far as carbonite hotspots. Okay, so we don't need to keep those bubbles up. Let's turn that off. Okay, so next thing, let's see if we can move the Colony Control Center around. Okay, here is our tug. And once again, going into docking mode. We will attempt to bring it to the Colony Control Center, which you see is right there. Now, technically the landing gear is supposed to be extended before I try to dock, but let's see if it works even without that. Nope, it won't. That's way too far away. Okay, let's park this. Oh, will the thing start? Well, we can apply brakes to it. Let's see. Okay, so I'm gonna apply brakes. Okay. Sort of. Next time I need to get some SAS on here or some sort of reaction wheel, because this is otherwise it's going to be so wobbly. Okay, switch back to the tug. Brakes off. Forward. Not too fast. Docking like. Yeah, docking port magnetism was felt. I'm trying to move back, but... Nope. No, it's just... I don't think they're docked. It's sort of a weird situation. Are they docked? No. Set as target. This thing's still spinning out of control. They're not docked, so what's up? Oh, maybe if I'm in this mode. Still don't quite understand what's going on here. Maybe let's retract this gear. This. I think we docked there. I think it was these struts that were getting in the way, and that was the problem. Okay, let's see if it moves. Let's go back to docking mode. There's not enough traction, I think. Oh no, this one has its brakes on. Okay. It's moving. Let me make sure it's not moving just because of the slope. Let's go the other direction. Okay. I don't feel safe about going further than like 1 meter per second. That's that direction, this direction. Okay, very, very slowly. It'll be a little bit tedious. We'll try and land them very close to each other. I hope we're not going to be too distant. But yeah, I think this will work. I mean, for now, until we get something a little bit better. Okay, so I'm not too sure how tedious it is going to be, but I'm going to leave it as is. I guess I'll just leave it like this for now. And so, I'm going to... Last thing for this episode is to land the Karbonite Miner here, the helmet Karbonite Miner. So let's get that down. And so here we are with the helmet Miner. Preparing to mine for the benefit of Kerbal kind. And we're pretty much where I want to be for descent. And we want to descend quickly because, again, it's going to be in the dark. Oh, this is going... Yeah, this is going retrograde, so actually I want to descend it on this side. The helmet miner does not have very much by way of reaction wheel control here. You can see my turn here. And the pitch, I'm trying to slow down the pitch here. Yeah. That's about as good as it goes, so landing with it will be a little bit cumbersome. Gonna get the gear down first. I'll retract the solar panels in a bit. It's got monopropellant though, so if we really need to, RCS is a thing. Looks like I'm a little bit too far north. Okay, it's going to be sort of weird approaching from the opposite side here, but no big problem, I don't think. Okay, I'm going to turn lights on. Got to retract solar panels as well. So we've got 1 hour of battery life. Looks like our lights are all downward facing, so don't really have any lights on the vehicle itself. Now remember, the helmet miner has enough fuel so that it can take off from the surface, deliver whatever carbonite it has in reserves, and then return to the surface on the same fuel. So, and then it'll refuel on the ground, of course. The amount of carbonite it takes to refuel itself is huge compared to the actual carbonite it delivers to anything in orbit. But for now, that's the system. Eventually, what we will have is potentially something that drills carbonite and, I don't know, possibly picked up by something else. Or we could just convert it on the surface, if that's what we want to do. Of course, we can convert on the surface using this. It carries its converter. So what we could do is just add a pipe using Kerbal attachment system and just truck it over to somewhere or something like that. We could have just a liquid fuel oxidizer truck. Let's actually kill more horizontal velocity. It's a little bit troublesome because I'm gonna turn RCS on because it's very hard to maneuver this thing. No, I think I maybe. No, it's all right. I was wondering when to engage Smart ASS to keep us vertical. And we're okay. The miner's lights are barely visible on the ground. Meters within safe touchdown limits. Meters. Contact detected, engine off. Landing lights off, RCS off. Alright, let's see if we can proceed with mining activities. Solar panels extended. Smart ASS off. Now, these mods have all been updated, and I don't know about these mini drills. They're sort of semi... I don't know if they're still fully functional parts. We'll see. It's possible that they've been deprecated or something. I've deployed the drill, but I think I have to say extract carbonite. Right. Okay, we're extracting carbonite. I don't really need both drills deployed. Going to it can refuel solid fuel. It doesn't look like it's got a monopropellant converter. So we'll have to get the monopropellant from the station. But we're gonna replenish LFO, liquid fuel and oxidizer. And that's fine. I mean, we didn't use that much more propellant to get back down here, and we probably won't use too much to get back to the station, so the station can refuel that for now, though we'll want a way to refuel it with miner. But okay, so we have once again started carbonite extraction activities. We are reasonably close to our colony control center at 250 meters. The colony control center can be moved around with some difficulty, but not too much. It's just a matter of time rather than actual difficulty. So yeah, I'd say that, and of course our emergency habitat is now upright. We have resolved the frame rate issue, so I think things are looking up. Oh, and by the way, no crashes during this recording. So So all things good. Perhaps some of that is active texture management aggressive. Some of it may have been the updates to the USI mods. So all is well, and we will proceed with further activities in the next episode. So with that, thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this episode, please do press like. If you have any comments or suggestions, please leave them in the comment section below, and I'll see you next time.